Good afternoon. Welcome to Immaculate Heart of Mary Catholic Church. It is the third Sunday of Lent, and the readings may be found in your red worship, 1034. That's 1034. Please join in our opening hymn, found again in the red worship, 478. It's Merciful God, and we are singing the Lent Gathering Refrain, stanzas 5 and 6. Again, stanzas 5 and 6. Please stand.
Gather your people, merciful God. Gather the longing, the lost and unsure. Gather your people, merciful God. Name us and claim us as yours. Surely you alone refine us. You give us grace for lives made new. Forging through your fire and radiance, a sacrifice worthy for you. Gather your people, merciful God. Gather the longing, the lost and unsure. Gather your people, merciful God. Name us and claim us as yours. Surely you alone redeem us. You fill our dust with holy breath. Bursting from the grave in glory, you rise from the ashes of death. Gather your people, merciful God. Gather the longing, the lost and unsure. Gather your people, merciful God. Name us and claim us as yours.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Brothers and sisters, to prepare ourselves to celebrate these mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned, in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. O God, author of every mercy and of all goodness, who in fasting, prayer, and almsgiving have shown us a remedy for sin, look graciously on this confession of our lowliness, that we who are bowed down by our conscience may always be lifted up by your mercy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, God delivered all these commandments. I, the Lord, am your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that place of slavery. You shall not have other gods besides me. You shall not carve idols for yourselves in the shape of anything in the sky above, or on the earth below, or in the waters beneath the earth. You shall not bow down before them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, inflicting punishment for their father's wickedness on the children of those who hate me, down to the third and fourth generation, but bestowing mercy down to the thousandth generation on the children of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not leave unpunished the one who takes his name in vain. Remember to keep holy the Sabbath day. 6 days you may labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. No work may be done than either by you or by your son or daughter, or your male or female slave or your beast, or by the alien who lives with you. In 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But on the seventh day, he rested. That is why the Lord has blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that you may have a long life in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male or female slave, nor his ox or ass, nor anything else that belongs to him. The word of the Lord.
The responsorial psalm may be found in your blue gather, page 26. Lord, you have the words. That's 2-6.
Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The Lord's rule is to be trusted, the simple find wisdom. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. The fear of the Lord is holy, abiding forever. The decrees of the Lord are true, all of them just. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. The precepts of the Lord are right, they gladden the heart. The command of the Lord is clear, giving light to the eye. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. They are worth more than gold, than the finest gold, sweeter than honey from the
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. But to those who are called, Jews and Greeks alike, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you. Gave his only Son, so that everyone believes in him might have eternal life. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Since the Passover of the Jews was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple area those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, as well as the money changers seated there. He made a whip out of cords and drove them all out of the temple area with the sheep and oxen, and spilled the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And to those who sold doves, he said, "Take these out of here and stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples recalled the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house will consume me." At this, the Jews answered and said to them, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" They answered and said to them, Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. Therefore, when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they came to believe the scripture and the words Jesus had spoken. While he was in Jerusalem for the feast of Passover, many began to believe in his name when they saw the signs he was doing. But Jesus would not trust himself to them because he knew them all. And did not need anyone to testify about human nature. He himself understood it well. The Gospel of the Lord. We're given this beautiful gospel today, and in a wonderful way, it's one of the most beautiful images of Jesus that we have all throughout the scriptures. Angry Jesus. It's beautiful. Okay. We're being a little bit facetious, of course, but there is something profoundly beautiful when we look at the anger of Jesus. Because, of course, his anger is not merely anger. It's anger with a wonderful vision. A vision that's backed by the full force of his love, love for God, love for his people, love for the Father, God the Father. So important. And of course, there's a further beauty as it draws us in, as Jesus draws us into that vision today for healing and even for salvation. So I want to speak a little bit into that today. His anger, that's of course first backed by his vision. So what does Jesus see here? Of course, he sees the temple. And what is the temple? It's the place where the very presence of God abides. The presence of God, as Jesus says, my Father's house. And the temple is that place where the Father continues to enter into, or continue to be in covenantal relationship with his people, where they come and they offer sacrifice, which is symbolic of them bringing their own lives to be in union with God the Father, so that they can reveal him more fully to the world. This temple was the place where everyone was meant to look to see, here is a people who is set apart by a God who loves them, by a God who is so ridiculously good. And here he is, Jesus comes into the temple. And what does he find? But he finds those, of course, they're selling things, which is not wrong in and of itself. But they're selling the sacrifices that are meant to be made. And if you read in between the lines, they're skimming off the top. They're making money for themselves. They're turning what is meant to be all for God into something that is gain for themselves. They're turning this most holy place into a kind of tourist trap for all of Israel who has to come to be engaged with God in this beautiful way, and in a way all of those who are coming are being abused by this system of selling, they're being abused in that way. And so Jesus approaches the temple, and he is so furious because this holy place is being abused. And what does he do to prove of what he's doing? He says, destroy this temple, and I will raise it on the third day. And of course, there he's speaking about his own body, which itself is such a mystery, because now he's saying that he himself is the home of the Father. He himself brings the very presence of God. And of course, he's also referring to that moment when he will offer his own sacrifice, bringing all of us into deeper union with God. He now is the temple. We're meant to see that's the whole vision that Jesus brings. So then through his death and through his resurrection, and of course, and through the whole mystery of his rising, ascending up into heaven, breathing out the Holy Spirit, he has united all of us to his body. He has done that. He's united us to his body. And if he's done that, then who is the temple? All of us, each and every one of us, are his temple. And what does that mean? It's the whole vision that he has. We are the presence of God the Father. In fact, we're the presence of the whole Trinity dwells within us. And the whole of our life, every joy, every suffering, every sacrifice that we make, every act of love is meant to be a beautiful offering before God to draw us into deeper union with him. We are the presence of God here on earth. I was on a retreat a couple of weeks ago, and I was really struck by our director who was preaching at a mass. And he said over and over again, if I can do this, if I could preach in such a way to help us to see there is no God apart from us because of what Jesus has done. Of course, God is larger, but God is here The dwelling of God is part of what he has done for us in Jesus. He has allowed the Lord to dwell here. And so it's for us to receive. And so enter Jesus's, that's Jesus's vision, and it's true, and we're meant to receive it. The home of the Father. Mentioned at the very beginning of Lent, a whole large part of our Lent is turning our eyes back to the Father. Today we're remembering that part of that is receiving, that we have God dwelling really within us. And so enter Jesus' anger, to allow him to enter into us and to allow his anger to have its way is a beautiful thing, because his anger upturns everything within us that says we are not the temple of God. Everything within us that militates against his presence. And what are those things? They could be a million things. It might just be for us how we view ourselves. I'm just a terrible sinner, distanced from God. The truth of that, of course, is I am a sinner. But the untruth is that I'm distanced from God. And so we allow Jesus' anger to go through, upturn that cart, so that we can see more deeply. No, we are the presence of God. I am, and you are. We have the presence of God living within us. One of the nasty tricks of the evil one, the accuser, is that after we sin, he will always remind us of our sin. And of course, he'll lay all sorts of labels on us. You are the one who does this or this. You're the sinner. You are a great sinner who's removed. You should be embarrassed or whatever. And of course, the truth of it is we are sinners. That's true, and that's why we're constantly repenting and turning back to God. But the untruth is that God is distant from us. It's what God has done for us. He has brought his life into our own. And that's not arrogant. In a way, it's arrogant for us to deny that, to refuse to believe how close God is. So today we're being invited to receive the wonderful and beautiful vision of Jesus, to receive more deeply that God has chosen to dwell not just among us, like above us, but has chosen to live within us. And so we're meant to receive that. That truth itself changes our life. And so we drink that in more deeply today, receive it more fully. And so to live it more fully during this beautiful season of Lent. Let's stand together and proclaim our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With confidence in our Father, we turn to him with our needs.
For the church, that our zeal for God's house may consume us through the passion that we bring to proclaiming the gospel and witnessing it through our actions, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our leaders around the world may find God's wisdom in the commandments and shape their nation's laws to foster respect for truth, for life, and for each other, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For modern-day money changers and all who take part in commerce, that they may treat others fairly and put ethics before profit, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are completing their preparations for the Easter sacraments, especially Katie Cleveland and Sandy Silver, that they may realize the wisdom in God's commands, we pray.
Lord,
for all of us who make up this parish, that we always keep this holy building a living temple of the risen Christ, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Giovanni James Bertani, who is being baptized in our church this weekend, for those who are sick or homebound, and for Nancy Dickinson, for whom this holy mass is being offered, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Ever faithful God, you gave us the commandments as a sign of your covenant with those you love. Grant us the grace and strength to keep that covenant as you hear the prayers we make, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. As the gifts are being prepared, please join in singing out of your Blue Gather, 290, Deep Within. That's 290.
Deep within, I will plant my love, not on stone, but in your heart. Follow me, I will bring you back. You will be
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be pleased, O Lord, with these sacrificial offerings, and grant that we who beseech pardon for our own sins may take care to forgive our neighbor. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by your gracious gift each year, your faithful await the Paschal feasts with a joy of minds made pure, so that more eagerly intent on prayer and on the works of charity, and participating in the mysteries by which they have been reborn, they may be led to the fullness of grace that you bestow on your sons and daughters. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. You, therefore, Almighty Father, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves had turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also together with your Son, and in the saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity, and an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us in communion with Francis our Pope and Bernard our Bishop and all the bishops and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, with our brothers and sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
As we approach God's table, please join in singing out of your blue gather, 349, Come to the Water. That's 349.
Should you spend your life except for the Lord?
And let all who toil, let them come to the water. And let all who are weary, let them come to the Lord. All who labor without rest, how can your soul find rest except for the Lord? Let all the poor, let them come to the water. Bring the ones who are laden, bring them all to the Lord. Bring the children. I gladly take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock within our weary land. A home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way. From the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day. The cross of Jesus, my eye at times can see the very dying form of one who suffered there for me. And from my stricken heart with tears to wonders I confess.
The wonders of redeeming love and my unworthiness. Take, O cross, your shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face. Content to let the old go by, to know no gain, no loss. My sinful self, my only shame, my glory all the cross.
Let us pray. As we receive the pledge of things yet hidden in heaven and are nourished while still on earth with the bread that comes from on high, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in mystery may come to true completion through Christ our Lord. Amen. We have our announcements. Just a reminder that during Lent, we will offer the Stations of the Cross at 7 p.m. We have several ways of giving alms this Lent. Specifically, we are looking for donations to ICA, gift cards for the homeless, and also monetary donations for Easter baskets for Mary's Place. Our Lenten Penance Service will be on Tuesday, March 12th at 7 p.m. Our final Lenten Fish Dinner is this Friday, March 8th. You don't want to miss it, and of course, please do not forget your $1 off coupon in the bulletin. Our welcome to our Lenten Evensong, which are held each Tuesday during Lent at 4:30 p.m. in the church. It's a beautiful way to reflect during our Lenten journey. If you haven't signed up for a small group yet and would like to, we can help you at the table and the gather space, or you can register through our website. Our first week of small groups was a huge success, and feedback is that they are loving it. Tickets have gone on sale for Notre Dame Academy's production of The Little Mermaid. The dates are March 21st through the 24th. All details are in the bulletin. Finally, if you please join me in just offering a word of, or an applause of gratitude for our young musicians, and of course also for Melody and Rich. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
As we ready ourselves to go, please join in singing out of your blue gather, 461, You Are Mine. That's 461, and we're singing stanzas 1, 2, and 3. That's 1, 2, 3.
Come to you in the silence. I will lift you from all your fear. You will hear my voice. I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am here. I am hope for all who are hopeless. I am eyes for all who long to see. In the shadows of the night, I will be your light. Come and rest in me. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me, I will bring you home. Strength for all the despairing, healing for the ones who dwell in shame. All the blind will see, the lame will all run free, and all will know my name. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by I will bring you home.